I'll go into the system. Now we're going live on the streaming. Then I have to mute things for a second. Just so you said like a 20, 30 second delay from one to the other. Okay. There you go. And then I put that there. That's on. And let me share my screen of this one. Perfect. You can see the screen, right? I usually follow my official timer, which is the iPhone. And then we'll start. We have a few people on. Usually it takes out, everybody comes in about exact time or minute or something. I think we have about 100 so far. 45 there, but 30 or 40 on the other side. I don't know if maybe Burkhard is there. Let me double check. Just double checking. Okay. All right. So it's time. Let me first thank everybody for coming once again to the seminar today, the online SPICE and Scrum Classic seminars led by the Spin Fundamental to the Interdisciplinary Center SPICE and the Collaborative Research Center Spin Plus X between MICE and Casus Alpha, led by Martin Schliemann, Burka Hillebrands, and Matthias Chloe. And just as everybody by now knows, this is a Zoom webinar. Meaning that as a participant, you only are hearing the person that is talking and the presentation being shown. But please write in the Q&A any questions that you may have. And then I will then afterwards give you the floor or this microphone privileges to ask the question to the speaker. And if not, if you speak at some work, just let me know and I will ask the question for you after the talk ends. Then just briefly, it's my pleasure to introduce the speaker today, Ulrich Rossler. He's a staff research member at IFW in Dresden in the Institute. He has his PhD from University of Göttingen, and he has many interests, of course, but the interest that brings him to SPICE and Spin Plus X is his interest in computational materials physics, particularly magnetic systems, but has a long history of beautiful, beautiful work, also with Bakhtanov and others, in skirmion physics. And we had the recent pleasure a few years ago of a wonderful tutorial he gave in one of the SPICE workshops. And he's always a great speaker and I'm looking forward to his talk. So I'll stop sharing here and go ahead and share your, Ulrich, your slides when you have a chance. Great. Okay, and go ahead and I'll mute myself here and start whenever you like.
Okay, so thanks for the introduction and the kind words, and in particular for the opportunity to speak here. What I will be talking today is some idea which indeed goes back very, very long time, and I will have a long time to motivate what it is about. Last week, I heard Albert Feld talking about skirmions in part of his talk about two-dimensional systems with skirmions. And in the end, someone asked whether this will be soon applied. And he said in 6 to 10 years, he believes it will be applied. This is also motivation why we may want to do something else now. The motivation is naturally, and in this community, I need not introduce everything, textures in chiral magnetism beyond spirals and skirmions. And what I'm using is generally phenomenological theory. So we are doing usually continuum theory and have then very innocent looking continuum theory describing classical magnetism. But it doesn't work out that these systems are simple. the new ideas I want to bring forward to you is that if we recognize some system where inversion symmetry is in...
Can you hang on for a second? I think, can you start this sharing again, maybe, because of the slides? Matthias and some others seem to only see half of the slide somehow, but I see the fully, so I'm not sure if it's just Matthias. Go ahead and start the sharing again.
Okay.
I'm not sure why, because I see it okay, but Matthias, you said that you only see half a slide?
So I saw for the cover slide, the title slide, I like it was the third or so on the right, which was missing.
And then the rest, it was okay.
Yeah, you see.
Oh, I see, because it was, I think it was missing because
okay,
he
yeah,
had
yeah.
actually
yeah, yeah.
he
okay,
had so messed
no
up.
No problem then, okay.
I think you moved the title, I see.
Yeah, but the other things are fine.
The other thing is okay.
Let's go ahead.
The thing is okay. Yeah, I think he moved the title. Okay, great. Sorry.
I don't know that it is possible. So the thing is that one can do much more complicated things. And we may have seen somehow the tip of the iceberg, but this is at the very initial state. And I want to bring this forward to you and explain why we believe that something like this happens in multi-sublattice magnetic systems, and you have to really go there where the action is. And this happens only if you tune the system towards some multi-critical point. So you need many magnetic modes or many sublattices, and they should couple in a definite fashion. And then you can have what we are looking at. In the end, I will do some conjectures on amorphous glass-like ground states, which is another subject I'm very interested in, whether it's possible to have classical systems which should order, so should form a crystalline order in magnetism, just become ferromagnets or antiferromagnets with a nail order or some non-collinear ferrimagnetism or something like this, but in reality never do and are not able to do this. But I start again with this topological textures in magnetism, just to remind that this mechanism via Zaluzhinsky-Moria interactions, which you know very well, works out that under certain circumstances, you can have topological textures which are localized or extended in here in a very simple fashion, topological non-trivial succession of kinks, which will be handed. The next thing which we can do is the skirmions, and with a three-component vector order parameter, this is also the most advanced thing which we can do, which can be topological stable. So in a two-dimensional system, it just looks like this. And you have then countable units. There's a fundamental difference between this here, this object, and this here. This you can unwind very easily by just unwinding it in one direction. And then you see it is basically a ferromagnet, which you have twisted in space. This here is intrinsically inhomogeneous and has particle properties. This was the basic idea of Alexei Bogdanov when he first found this. And I will explain this again a bit, because from there, everything came in this field in the end that in a classical field like a research topic like continuum magnetism, something really new could be predicted and later found. So what I call now Zaluzhinsky models are really such continuum models where we say, okay, we have exchange interaction which force order parameter here, a staggered antiferromagnetic vector, which is distributed in space continually. So we are in a relatively large scale. And this penalizes deviations from this. This is just keeping everything parallel. Then you have exchange anisotropy and you have this Lifshitz invariance. The trick with this gradient terms is simply that you can have negative energy. This destabilizes everything and makes it inhomogeneous. Now, these terms arise naturally in the Landau theory of phase transitions, and usually people stop thinking about this when such terms arise and say Landau theory is not applicable. This is not completely true. There's a weaker form of Lifshitz criterion, which says, okay, there shouldn't be too many of them. One in one direction doesn't hurt You can still unwind it. You do not need to have such a twisted structure. And then you see that this term is null and void and doesn't influence the system at all. It gets dangerous if you can twist the system in more than two directions. This is why these Zaluzhinsky textures are in reality outside of the normal Landau-Ginzburg thinking of phase transition, because they make really inhomogeneous ground states. Now, I could stop with my talk by just telling you what was a basic idea and say, okay, now go and figure and find something. Namely, we can couple several ordering modes and having not only one ordering mode, like in this chiral ferromagnets. So for instance, I have a vector which describes indeed antiferromagnetism here, and I have a vector which describes ferromagnetism. And then there are certain systems which have so-called Lipschitz type invariants. So two different ordering modes coexisting should order at the same time, and there should be such an energy term. And there exist such systems, and quite a huge number of them can be found. If you do this coupling, and this would be exactly the metamagnetism, you couple ferromagnetic, basically antiferromagnetic system to something which is ferromagnetic, and this you can drive with an external magnetic field. So you transform it successively, but into a ferromagnetic state by flipping moments in the antiferromagnetic lattice. And by having such a term, then you get textures. Where do such terms come from? Naturally, mostly spin orbit coupling in non-centrosymmetric materials. But the trick is that antiferromagnetic order in certain more complicated lattices can also break inversion symmetry. And in that case, you will get such terms for free, and they need not be all from spin orbit coupling. They can be stronger. They can come also from direct coupling. So such effects are very strong. Eventually, and we can exploit them to make really a messy magnetic system in a completely clean magnetic crystal, for instance. So I could stop now and tell you, this is a message I want to convey, that there is something to be detected in this field by using this type of theory as a guiding principle. But I will, before that, make a detour through the scaling arguments about localized structures. This was the main obstacle for having extended, so spatially extended, but localized things like two-dimensional, multidimensional solitons, or even such ball-likes, like skirmions, which Skirme wanted to have, and which should describe in a continuum units, countable units. So the standard theory which we have when we look and we have a kink which rotates just through a certain space in one finite length in one direction says that if I have just exchange and terms which are potential terms and I blow up the scale or shrink it, then this object can be stable. So the potential curve of this looks like this versus the scaling parameter lambda. Only when I have Zaluzhinsky-Moria interactions, I can I stabilize baby skirmions, these two-dimensional localized things, which I can extend in the third direction as tubes. So these are vortices and baby skirmions. There you get a side a real minimum at a finite lambda, which stabilizes this whole thing. So this is really a physical argument about stabilizing such states. In three dimensions, I can have at least such a metastable minimum and eventually a real minimum depending on the parameters of the system if I have such chiral terms. Then I can have something like hedgehogs, spherolites, or real skirmions, which are balls, not the skirmions which you know. This whole thing runs under the name of Derrick scaling argument. This was how Alexei Bogdanov found in reality that there should be something in chiral magnets which does this. And this paper describes exactly this idea. And he says there can be three-dimensional units, but we have not seen them yet. Now I come to some simple ideas first with one dimensions. Naturally, I can classify any system which makes some, let's say, spin density order like this. This is two up, two down order for some reason, and can look whether there are terms which twist this. And I can twist something like this into extended texture. There are probably a great many of the materials which do this. And we wrote back then some paper about the material which should do this. This is exactly a related system to the iron selenide. Centrosymmetric magnetic system, which makes a spin density wave order, but makes also a helical order. And we wrote based on some ideas, phenomenology, where we see that in reality, such a system does not order like usual because it should violate this Lifshitz criterion. That it means a spin density wave state with a finite propagation vector for the antiferromagnetic order parameter may in reality twist in some such fashion. For instance, here the collinear one-dimensional thing may be twisted in such a cycloidal spiral state. This would be a Zaluschinsky spiral, but you could build up from this also skirmions or even ball solitons because you have the phase factor as an additional free parameter to describe such a structure, and you can run through this, and this would be so to say the possibility to twist not only in two directions but in three directions. This theory unfortunately probably doesn't apply to the iron tellure because iron tellure has not this smooth spin density wave, but for some reason, a much more complicated thermodynamical potential should be used. It has probably short period helical order because of exchange frustration. But still, the basic argument that this ordering transition here should not be second order and conventional applies even in that case, because we know only the propagation vector of this incommensurate spin density wave and can say this should not be a normal phase transition. And in fact, our experimental colleagues found some quasi-static precursor state or partial order above the establishment of this chiral, non-chiral spiral ordering, which takes place here. This shows you something which I want to emphasize. We need not know what the system does. We need to know the crystal symmetry and something about the order parameter. And then we can make already some prediction. We cannot say exactly what will happen, but we can say about the phase diagram some specific statements, and we can say which terms should be there, which eventually twist a simple ordering mode. For you who know group theory and Landau theory, a simple ordering mode is just the one which transforms like one irreducible representation. So symmetry pure type of ordering modes. Now, we can, this was so to say a failed attempt to have four component order parameter which we should use to describe something like a ball. And this is in the end what I want to see. Simultaneously at that time, we wrote a small paper and Andrei Leonov in his thesis calculated this, that if we have not a three component vector order parameter, but just four order components, then we can really make balls. And we can use Skirmes hedgehog ansatz to describe this. And this shows you how such a ball looks from the center in three dimension. It rotates like what you would call a vector order parameter, three of them, like in a nail skirmion, just cycloidal, but in all three directions in three-dimensional space. And internally from red to blue, there's another scale which rotates also. This allows us to make a topologically stable ball real skirmion. But this is only Skirmes hedgehog ansatz, and this object described by this theory, which should describe really structural glasses, metallic glasses, which are packed into icosahedral local short range order with a certain frustration, is a completely different theory than what Skirmy used, although the topology of this object is naturally exactly the same. Why is this so? Before I show here, this is from Andrei Leonov's thesis. He calculated then with such a basic model. One of the important things that we can eventually stabilize condensates of skirmions before a helical order takes place. This would be a temperature parameter, and this would be a longitudinal stiffness parameter, and you have such a avoided phase transition where in reality you nucleate here an amorphous packing of skirmion, which is then some such Russian doll principle that you have something which is composed of atoms and it forms again some assembly of balls and makes eventually a structural glass. This whole thing is different from what Skirmy did, and I want to emphasize this. Much before that time in field theory, the people who described elementary particles with fields and struggled to understand extended particles like the nucleon, the proton, and so on, devised two different ways how you can have multidimensional solid tones. And the Skirmy's way was, he includes higher order gradients. This is a scaling problem that you can have balls only if you have something to stabilize them. You cannot have stable ones with a simple gradient expansion, a phi phi theory and a squared gradient term of some other parameter. But there's another one, and this was mainly invented by Fadeev. You use a nonlinear gauge theory, non-Abelian gauge theory, and have a gauge and matter fields, and they stabilize also balls. There's a very nice early lecture of Sidney Coleman, which describes a lot of these things in terms of classical field theories, the problem of having lumps. So finite pieces of matter which we nucleate, but which need not to condense into extended phases. In the context you know in magnetism, therefore there are two different types of skirmions. In chiral helium magnets, we have something which Alexei Bogdanov saw, that you need not have the gauge field as a dynamical parameter, but you can have it as a background, a gauge background, which twists the structure. Beginning of February, Oleg Chernyshov gave a nice talk where he exactly explained this geometric idea that the Zaluzhinsky-Moria interaction and this Lifshitz invariance are nothing else like a geometry in curved space where this twisted structure likes to live. And this is exactly this set of special structures and theories where you have a gauge background which twists the system into eventually spirals. This would be the Zaluzhinsky spirals or finite lumps. The other way is higher order gradient terms, and this you can have if you have exchange frustration. Then you have to expand the gradient terms, here the exchange, to higher order. You see there is a square of the second derivatives of the order parameter. And there's the earliest paper where people tried this was probably this here by Abanov and Bakovsky. But in reality, all these spin models on a lattice, which have frustrated exchange couplings, belong to this class. Now, in the following, I will really talk only about this side. But what I have been talking, what I propose in multi-sub lattices, can actually work also in this, but there it is much more harder to find out system and describe system which should have a multi-sublattice coupled magnetism and these chiral twisting terms or other twisting terms which generate localized structures. So now we have an idea how to do multidimensional solid tones, and we have at least some idea that in magnetism it should work. And this question, can we find more types of textures which do something which we would like to have? So mesoscale structure, localized or extended, which are not just spirals or skirmions, we can answer. And what I want to see in magnetism finally is exactly like this. So you have something like a background wavy of, let's say, antiferromagnetism, and there you nucleate ferromagnetic droplets, three-dimensional things which swim around in this three-dimensional antiferromagnetic real crystal and may interact really like balls. This is a picture I have, and we have taken at least some step in this direction. Now, to explain the problem and why, how slowly it was to develop this, I tell you something about the coupling of some multidimensional sublattice magnets. This is tetragonale inverse Häusler alloys, and I worked a bit here with people in Claudia Felser's department on this system, and they describe it as a collinear antiferromagnet or ferrimagnet at high temperatures. There are two different sublattices. Here, this first one in blue, which makes a ferromagnetic order, and then opposite to this, another side. But at lower temperatures, you get non-collinear canting because of exchange interactions. This has nothing to do with Saluzhinsky-Moria, it just cants in this fashion. And if we do this more abstractedly, then we see that we have some such order at low temperatures. So the first sublattice is just ferromagnetic, and we have these two canted at a large angle sublattices of a weaker nature, which order only at lower temperature in this fashion. If we transform this into continuum theory, we have just a ferromagnetic sublattices and here staggered vector L and F describing these two sublattices. And I can write now a Landau expansion and have lots of term, and you need not read all this, but I have also, because it's non-centrosymmetric lattice in that case, I have Lifshitz invariants and Lifshitz types invariants, which are linear in gradients, which should destabilize this. Now, and a lot of anisotropies. Now, in reality, in this stage at high temperature, when only this F sublattice dominates, you have a chiral helimagnet, which depending on propagation direction, may be either cycloidal or helical. And this other sublattices here do not matter. And you have at the finite field a skirmion lattice, which is nowadays called antiskirmion lattice because of the special type of crystal symmetry in this system, but it doesn't matter exactly which type of this is. At low temperatures, people do seem not to know exactly what happens. And the reason is very clear. If you have want to describe textures in such a canted thing, you can describe this by such a triangle, which is just a rigid spin pattern, which is oriented in space without in arbitrary direction. Without spin orbit coupling, you can really rotate it in any way you want. With spin orbit coupling, you get Saluzhinsky spirals as one dimensional solutions, and there you have no problem. This looks then like this in a certain direction, a cycloidal half period. But if you want to do now a skirmion, you would say, okay, I go in one direction like the cycloid, and then I want to roll this in and make it a double twist structure, propagating this in all directions. But this doesn't work because in the center, you do not know how to orient these red spins, the staggered vector. So you need to introduce a defect here, and the two subsystems which influence each other are at the detriment to each other. They cannot really order in such a texture. And in this system where at high temperatures, the one dominates completely over the other, you can have only some defected texture or something very complicated, which we do not understand this. So in this material, because it has this complicated spin pattern, three-dimensional non-collinear ferrimagnetism. The Zaleshinsky-Moria interaction work towards a very complicated structure, which we do not understand yet. But this is the first example of an improper Zaleshinsky texture, because in this system, you can have couplings between the two different ordering modes here, only two of them, L and F, which look like this. But really, that this one system influences the other and vice versa will happen only at multicritical points. This is a finite statement in Landau theory. You can show that if such a term is there and one of the modes is rigid, you can eliminate it completely and get only an anisotropy. So these terms are in principle there if you build up a microscopic theory for a material, but in reality, they never matter. But in magnetism, we have the grand chance to tune system towards multicritical point. And this was the idea I had then, that we'd really tune a system towards a multicritical point by just using an antiferromagnet, which in a centrosymmetric system will have a very simple organization in a magnetic field. So if the anisotropy is relatively large in such a system, you will just flip all moments at the first order transition, and here you will have a tricritical point. At finer temperatures, at higher temperatures, there will be a continuous phase transition. Here you have a coexistence line where usually you will have domain states between the antiferromagnet and the ferromagnet. You can also look at weaker antiferromagnetic system, weaker anisotropy system, not a uniaxial anisotropy of very great strength. Then you will have a spin flop, and you will have here a bicritical point and here a coexistence line. But in this region here, in the two modes, ferromagnetic, which is equivalent to paramagnetic, spin polarized, and antiferromagnet, will interact in a certain fashion. Now, in some systems, you can write this Lifshitz type invariants, and then these two modes, which are strictly symmetry different, will start to speak to each other. And in the case of a polar system, for instance, you will at this coexistence line, you will be able to make mixtures where the system rotates simply from the antiferromagnetic to the ferromagnet and back and wins energy by this. And this is the idea of a metamagnetic texture. You have a coupling via Lifshitz invariance, via such chiral terms, and you get a very complicated organization. There are more complicated phases here and phase transitions depicted, but in reality, we do not know too much about these things, and this I present now, because we started to do some experimental work, and this was mainly Dmitry Sokolov's work, who was here in Andy McKenzie's department at the Max Planck Institute. And you see there are many co-workers. He did all the experiments on a certain crystal, which I present now, and a lot of neutron scattering work was done. The system which we choose was this crotonate, which is a bilayer system, a very simple antiferromagnet in reality. So there are two ruthenium sublattices, but in reality, these are bilayers. These are ferromagnetically coupled internally and antiparallel in the ground state here. The thing is that this crystal system, a Ruttleston-Popper phase, is polar, and we knew that it has a very complex phase diagram at high temperatures. The magnetization process indicated some such metamagnetic structure. That means you have here some such change of slope and the intermediate range. And this range here above the antiferromagnetic A phase in the temperature field phase diagram has at the high temperature site no thermodynamic anomaly, which is obvious. So there's a very strange phase here. And we knew that in this direction, that Zaleshinsky-Moria interactions, which are possible in this system, apply. Now in SANS, in small angle neutron scattering, the people saw that there are some modulations of a certain length. And also the antiferromagnetic order parameter gave signature of changing when you crossed the line from the collinear antiferromagnetic state to this one. And we take this as example of creating some such mixed texture out of ferromagnet and antiferromagnet as a first example. And the depiction how this looks like is that in this direction, in the A direction, you have a rotation of the two sublattices, the red and green one, from a ferromagnetic orientation into an antiferromagnetic orientation and back. And the ferromagnetic part is polarized along the field, which is applied along the polar axis, which is here along B. So this was the first evidence that something like this coupling several ordering modes simultaneously really can work, and that one can also predict that such unusual things happen in a real magnetic system. The theory is naturally very complicated. Why is this so? Because we are near a tricritical point, and this means that we have a Landau expansion which goes up to sixth order. And I put this here only to frighten you. This means this phenomenological continuum theory is exceedingly complicated. We have also some anisotropy, so the homogeneous terms are already many. But it gets really messy because we have an orthorhombic system if we write all the allowed Lifshitz invariants which affect the thermodynamic of this system. You see here, I have written this now in a compact form, and you best read only the first line. There is such a term which is linear in gradients, but this is only part of this expression which I have to consider. These are really quartic terms. These are very high terms, and this means the theory which one has to solve is highly nonlinear, and one can have very strange effects. For instance, if one has a very high anisotropy system, a localized structure which is stabilized by these terms will be an extremely high nonlinear object. Now, I promised that I will speak a bit about candidates, and there are so many in reality that one need not end, or I could talk 2 days or 3 days. There are whole families of materials which do this. In principle, any acentric polar antiferromagnet has such terms, and if you can tune them towards full saturation, like in this europium system here, you will get intervening phases which are complicated textures and may be such mixtures between ferro and antiferromagnetism. Evidence for this has been indeed seen. There's a work here from, I think this is from Tokura's lab even, where they claimed that there's an A phase in this type of acentric europium system. The nickel has no moment. Sometimes we will find also systems which are accidentally degenerate, and this is my favorite thing, and I venture now a prediction that at some point we will find out that this is one of the most interesting antiferromagnets which we have around everywhere. This is iron oxyhydroxyoxide. This is a weathering product in the upper earth crust, and is probably the most abundant antiferromagnet in the earth crust. It's called after Goethe even, because he collected some minerals, and someone called it later in the last 200 years like this. This is a centrosymmetric system, but it has degenerate antiferromagnetic ground states probably if you switch off on the spin orbit coupling. There's one which is special parity even, and one which is odd. My Coy and co-workers have done a lot of experiments maybe 30 years ago, and this is long time ago, and claimed that this has really coexisting different ordering. The magnetic order is not completely solved up to now. This has to do also with the difficulty to synthetically create such single crystals out of this material. But they claim that it is somehow fluctuatingly, strangely mixed state, and it's not completely clear which ground state it is. But these two ordering modes support Lipschitz type invariance. So they are not completely independent and simply coexist like in domain state, like in this domain state between a ferromagnet and antiferromagnet, but there are two antiferromagnetic modes which coexist and couple and are coupled via such twisting terms. This means there should be textures in this material. Some DFT work supports this, that these are energetically at least close. This is a four-sublattice system. And this is certainly something which one could investigate if one has chemistry lab and a neutron reactor with a SANS machine or something like this. This is certainly one of the nicest and sweetest things, but this shows also that you can find such systems only accidentally. It is a lucky find to something like this. Now it is already heavily complicated, and I want to make it even more complicated. I want to do now something where the order is completely depressed by such terms. And this can be done too. This is work which hopefully will be soon printed or appear. This is earlier talk and I've misprinted Werner Schweiger's name. The experiment was done by Werner Schweiger from Jülich with Johannes Reim, who was a PhD student at the time. And I came late to it via Martin Walter, who grew the single crystals. These people are doing spin-polarized neutron scattering and can measure chirality of the structure factor. This system is in principle a classical magnet, but has two sublattices, a Kakome lattice and a triangular lattice, which are coupled. And it is polar, as you see at the space group. What they find is lumps of magnetic order locally, which are chiral cycloids, which are in the IB plane going outwards and have a finite extension in C direction in this hexagonal system. And this is naturally exactly when we write down the phenomenological theory, what one would expect, because there are several sublattices, so I can couple them and I have some Lipschitz invariants which twisted in cycloidal fashion in this form, in the AB plane, which has here X and Y gradients. And there are couplings in the Z direction between different modes, here L and M. But why doesn't it order? Now it comes the most complicated part of this talk. Oleg Chernyshov showed you this, that one can unwind such a gauge background. And this I can do the same with many order parameter components. So I have two order parameter components, one and two, which may be sublattice magnetizations. I couple this and write all the terms which I want to have and have some Lipschitz type invariants here between one and two. You need only for these terms, always read the first term. I can combine this in a larger order parameter, which has six components, say, or many more, and rewrite the gradient terms, which are square gradient terms and linear gradient terms, by just closing the square into this form. And then you recognize that there is a frozen gauge background. It's just a square term with a covariant derivative. This is a geometry which we are looking at. And if we have something like this, then we can say, okay, in reality, I can unwind it every way. So like the spiral I did to show that it's in reality just a collinear order. So my space on which this lives can be unwound in a certain way. But if I can create non-collinear lumps of order in this system, as we believe to be the case, then I can do this in an infinite many ways. And this is a case that you should spontaneously break the gauge fixing, which one should do. This is locally impossible spontaneously. And this means in such highly rotatable multi-sublattice magnets, one should not have see any magnetic order. Because I have six order components, if I couple, say, two sublattices, these lumps are no skirmions. They are not topologically stable. They have localized always degrees of freedom that I can unwind them, and they can localize localized also support fluctuations, which are uncommon. This means the system will usually not order, and there may be a very strong prohibition to order unless I offer some anisotropy. Naturally, in magnetic crystals, we will have this often. And this is a way out that in the end, such a system may be ordering because of anisotropy. Anisotropy in the order parameter space, in this high dimensional space, or because of real spin orbit coupling driven anisotropies, which fixes magnetic moments in certain directions. Here is written for the expert something which you may later read, hopefully, that there is some topology in this game. There can be some other types of different topological states in such textures, but I will skip this. Now, I'm already approaching the end. What do we know about such theories which describe such multi-sublattice chiral magnets? In reality, if the number of order parameter components is infinite, we know from this work from Nusinov that it doesn't order at all. This is one of the systems which describes really structural classes which avoids ordering, also having a tendency to order. So with this, I can tell you, we can look into systems which avoid order and stay classical liquids down to very low temperatures by the following ingredients. We should have magnetic systems with multi-criticalities. So many sublattices with competing primary modes should exist. And geometric frustration can help because this is under constraint system, which means you have automatically many such modes. But we should have also broken inversion symmetry of some sense. Then we get the Lifshitz type invariance and have this frozen gauge background. And such systems will generically form classical amorphous ground states. Here I have put a small list of examples and I choose them such, you see, they are all non-centrosymmetric space groups. They are clean crystals, no Quinch disorder. And they are very diverse. There are quantum magnets like cuprates here. There are some such iron pnictites. There are some systems which are having groups of atoms, but there are also classical systems, and you can have, for instance, such intermetallic compounds. There are these types of very exotic magnetic materials which all do not order, or if they order in a very strange fashion. So with this, I'm coming to the end. This slide is, so to say, the gist of this particle, what I wanted to tell you today. This improper Zaleshinsky textures is something which one has to look for. But one may have it under our nose already for a long time in systems which are really complicated. They will generically not have easily real long range order, three dimensional, because they violate this Lifshitz criterion for the Landau theory for the magnetic ordering. If they are there, they can twist several modes. It's not necessary that the crystal system itself is acentric. As I said, there can be also systems which break inversion symmetry by the antiferromagnetic order. If we have such systems and they are highly isotropic, we can create lumps, local magnetic order, just as I wanted to have. If I offer a magnetic field and the switching from the antiferromagnetic to the ferromagnetic state, I may create even balls or droplets of ferromagnetic order swimming around in some background, which may be paramagnetic or antiferromagnetic. And there are really a very great number of systems where we can study this. the guiding principle doesn't require that we understand them in detail until that point when we really want to understand this material. But as candidate materials, we can really go by crystal databases and some rough ideas where to look for them. And with this, I'm at the end and thank you for listening. Names of coworkers who inspired me were all sprinkled through the talk. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Okay, for the wonderful talk, always clear as always. So let's see, Igor, I think, has the first talk. So whoever likes to ask a question, please raise your hand. That would be the best way, or just write your question on the on there directly. So I think, Igor, you are first. So go ahead and Igor, ask your question.
Oh, that's... That question was related to something back in your presentation. When this ruthenium 2-3-3-7 compound, you may remember that there was quite a vigorous activity around this point because of temperature derivative of resistivity, which was linear in about this, yeah. So what you, the phase that you mark here as MMT, I think that the same phase that people found to have non-Fermi liquid resistivity behavior. There was a lot of activity around that and a lot of most exotic theories. So I wonder if you can relate this fact that the system has actual linear resistivity dependence only there, only in that region, which this scenario of unconventional magnetic phase there.
They tried this naturally. I mean, this is really anti-McKenzie.
She started that, right? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Dmitry Sokolov came to me and asked me for systems which could be skirmionic or something, and I said, you come from McKenzie, this system is a candidate because I knew the symmetry in the phase diagram. We tried this in this paper. This is published 2 years ago. There are data on the transport also, electrical transport, but we have no closed picture on this. The system is very complicated. As you see, there's a spin reorientation transition and there's a metal insulator transition. So the electronic structure changes from going from this AFMA to AFMB. And we are in principle only in this high temperature region we worked as a reference. But my impression is that this complicated texture we believe to be here is really instrumental for this strange behavior of the transport. Right.
So that basically it's not like breaking down a Fermi liquid picture, but rather some strangely behaving excitations which serve as temperature dependent scatterers. Is that exactly the message? Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm not a transport guy, but I have seen the same thing in manganese silicon B20 phase, the same thing. Whenever we have this strange magnetism, we have also strange.
Well, yeah, there's a very direct relation in a way that if your model allows for strongly scattering very low energy excitations, that would definitely emulate this linear behavior that they are. We're so happy about.
Exactly. This is the point in all this system that you suddenly have a phase space which have completely unusual magnetic excitations, especially localized also on all these localized static structures which are
described. It's very, very interesting, and I actually like this explanation much better. I mean, it directly relates to 1-1-3 phases where we do know that just regular magnons are main scatterers and also provide for unusual temperature dependence, although not linear. So that sort of fits in the general picture very well. Okay, thank you.
So Stefan, you're next, and then Sumit.
Yeah, this is Stefan Brügel from Jülich. I would like to say that is a very, very nice talk, a very insightful talk. I enjoyed it very much. I have one question also to this calcium ruthenate. You give an expansion, so to say, micromagnetic expansion, where you also have Lifshitz invariants, which are proportional to L times L times the Lifshitz invariant, yeah, exactly here. So I would like to ask you in this W sub four, whether I can understand them as Lifshitz invariants produced not by the spatial non-centrosymmetric symmetry breaking, but by the magnetic symmetry breaking of a magnetic space group.
At low temperatures, certainly. There's a problem always that if you break by magnetism, so by the magnetic phase transition itself, the inversion symmetry, this is induced effect. And I'm aware that you and your group are working on these issues. But then you have this only at low temperatures, and you should not use such an expansion then for these induced effects where around this tricritical point where I want to use this expansion here.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm at the paramagnetic side. But I'm aware that I toyed with the idea that I should cite some of your work on multi-spin interactions to motivate why such terms are there, and then tell you, but these are also entropic terms here.
Okay.
I mean, the quartic terms in the Landau expansion are in reality mode coupling terms. And the higher order terms are finally also mode coupling terms, and the vital part they are the entropic terms, because this is here, I use this expansion as a classical free energy function. So the distance to what you are doing with multi-spin interactions is very far. Mm-hmm. It's not straightforward. But I'm very grateful that you are doing this work, because in metals, I believe that these multi-spin interactions, which generate then Lifshitz invariants, are really important to understand in the end quantitatively such systems. And in the further future, I hope that one can really derive some of these parameters we use here for the continuum theory from microscopic calculations. This is, I think, still the best route to do this.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Sumit, you next, if you'd like to ask your question.
Sure. Thank you for this wonderful talk. My question is very general, actually. So, for example, let's say if we want to study an electronic system and want to know whether it is topologically non-trivial or not, first we look at the band structure, identify if there is a gap or not, and calculate some topological invariant like Berry curvature. And then we look in the experiment, what is the result for, let's say, Hall conductance. Now, if we look similar thing in a magnetic system, which observables we should look at, and what is the experimental data we can rely on?
Okay. I'm not aware of so to say, this smoking gun principle, but I can tell you one story about the story of the skirmion lattice and B20. When this first paper from Tokura group about iron germanium and the skirmion lattice came out, we got from Grigoryev and Maleev in Petersburg a mail that they now believe that this exists, skirmion lattices. So I can tell you the proof for experimentalists consists in doing microscopy in real space. Once you see it, you believe it. And in reality, imaging is possible in all this system. Eventually a bit indirect via small angle neutron techniques, but in the end, I believe this metamagnetic textures will be the same. We can make indirect inferences via transport or anything, but the real proof and that people start to believe that this is real will be real imaging. And one can do microscopy on these systems. This is not a problem nowadays. We are down at the nanoscale, and hopefully one can soon also image antiferromagnetic textures. So there are really possibilities now. And I believe this is the way to go because this systems are also, as I said, not necessarily topological. They are topological only in the form of textures being incompatible, so that this space of possible textures is decomposed in several components. This may happen eventually, but otherwise they are really geometric objects and living in real space. Okay. I hope this answers your question.
I get the direction here. Thank you.
Yonko, you're the next question. I think the last question.
Absolutely great talk. Thank you very much. Things are complicated as they are, but my question is kind of, I'm not trying to make them more complicated, but have you explored the coupling to non-ordering degrees of freedom, like to strain? What I'm tending to is that even in the simplest Landau expansion that's in the textbooks, if one adds strain, this by integrating out the strain because it's non-ordering, one ends up with a third order term and a first order transition. And so essentially one loses the criticality of the situation. So I don't need to expand on this. I myself spend a lot of time on trying to figure out critical behavior magnetostriction, where such coupling to the non-ordering strain field is important. But what do you have to say to this? It's like adding a complication on top of a complication, but then one would lose a lot of, very many of these critical lines between the faces will turn to first order lines, maybe. I just don't know in this complicated situation.
Yeah, thank you for this question. This is a very important point, naturally. As I said, this Lifshitz invariance you can write in reality in almost all systems with other phonon modes, strain, what you have in real materials. But they will usually not be operational. And if you write down the effective theory, which the Soviet school researchers have done, you end up with anisotropies. So this is a very important source for anisotropies. And then you are right, you may generate terms which turn the system into first order transitions. And this is a nuisance for this aim that one creates amorphous ground states, because this will then pin and will exactly lead to phase transitions, mostly of the first order. The issue here is magnetism is not so strongly coupled to the lattice, at least in the 3D or 4-5D magnetic systems. With rare earths, it may be a bit different. So there we may have a chance. These terms here can actually also exist in just structural phase transitions. And in the old school, who studied this also 30-40 years ago, they never considered multidimensional multidimensional modulations, always only one-dimensional incommensurate systems, and they never considered coupling of modes, which exists in the, there are papers also, theoretical papers in Shedv in the Soviet school, maybe from such people like Sannikov and there are many names who did such work and pointing out that such terms can really turn phase transitions in materials into very complicated things. The problem there is it is difficult to tune them towards multicritical points, but this methodology is really much wider. And I hope that I have at least two or three systems which are non-magnetic which show such behavior, but this is always only a lucky find. And in all these systems, coupling via such gradient terms in a, so to say, a comprehensive theory with strain and what you have in a real material will exist naturally, but these terms are mostly irrelevant. One can show this more or less rigorously, that one can eliminate them and get the effective theory for the one-ordering soft mode, but then they create anisotropies. So this is really for this, my aim to have an amorphous ground state in a clean magnet, it is certainly a problem.
Okay.
Okay, thanks for this nice question.
Thank you, Yoko. And Cameron, go ahead and ask your question. I think it's the last question that we have today.
Thank you. I should say probably I've got a bit of an inside interest in this calcium ruthenate material, which I've studied myself. But my question was about the coupling of the different modes. So you couple the AFM zero fill modes with some kind of field-induced ferromagnetic mode via these Lifshit terms. I was wondering if you could also just couple the two AFMA and AFMB modes via Lifshit's terms without any field-induced.
They are in reality coupled. You have the Lifshitz invariance for them because, you know, in magnetism, you can switch off spin orbit coupling totally and describe the magnetic orders first without it. So this is the color group for the experts where you have just a crystallographic group and then some vector order parameter, which is axial vector. The nail vector and not the magnetic representation analysis, but such a way. And then you switch on spin orbit coupling and then you have a normal Lifshitz invariant. And this exists in this material and is a vital part of the thing that this antiferromagnetism and the ferromagnetism, if you give it a chance, will rotate. But in this system, it seems to be that the homogeneous potential term anisotropy, maybe I find this quickly, is so strong, but changes sign when this transition comes. These are these terms here. So just a second order anisotropy are such stronger than this Zaluszynski-Moria, so that we are in a regime where you have not a spiral ground state, but a collinear ground state. So, but this is just one of the problem that in this material, if one writes for the tricritical point now a thermodynamic potential, I have so many terms that I cannot really say where we are. And the material itself changes electronically, drastically at this transition from A to B to also, so it is less than ideal to do, let's say, principled studies. As a material, it's extremely interesting, naturally.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, with that, I think that's the end of the questions. And I thank you again, Ulrich, for always, as I knew, you have great insightful talks and very pedagogical and easy to follow. This is great. Looking forward. And I'm curious, I will look back later that other material that is so abundant. So that's actually interesting.
Okay, that was a bait. Yeah, naturally.
Yeah, it's a great hook, yeah. But once again, thanks again to everybody. And we continue, of course, next week. Next week we will continue with the next talk. Please join us. I think Theo is the one giving next week, so Theo Reisen, which is always interesting and amusing to hear. So please join us as well. Okay. And with that, I'll thank everybody, and I'll close here for the rest. And I'll meet some of you in another room. Thank you.